For his compassion has never failed. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness.
Let's stand together. Come on.
So faithfulness, O God. You wrestle with us.
Even the
God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth gives way. Come on, let's sing this song together. Praise His name.
Lord, I come, I confess, bowing here, I find my rest. Without You, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart.
Come on, church, lift it up.
Lord, I need You. Oh. Your grace is more, where grace is found, is where You are. Where You are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. Yeah. Soul to rise to You when temptation comes my way, when I cannot stand up full on You. Jesus, You're my hope and stay.
Come on, Southland, let's go.
Lord, I need You. Oh, I need You. I want defense. righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. My one defense, thy righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. My one defense, thy righteousness. Oh God, how I need you.
It's interesting when we think of what's happening in the world today, and especially what happened yesterday, how we put these services together weeks in advance, and the songs that we choose, and we say to ourselves, God, in this moment, your grace is enough, and we need you. We need you desperately, and that's why we come together to pray in these services, because we know how much we need the Lord, but how much the world needs the Lord, and our nation needs the Lord. And we have to remember, nations and communities are made up of people, and when we pray, we're praying for people. And so we remember that we need to pray for former President Trump and his healing and his family's peace. We pray for President Biden and our Congress so that they would have wisdom on how to deal with the violence in the world today. We can't forget that while a national figure has brought our attention to the violence in our country, each day, moms and dads all over the place in towns and cities are grieving the loss of their children because of violence, and we see it everywhere. And so today, we want to make sure we're praying as we see what is happening in the world when it runs far from God. So we pray for the Lord to draw people back to him. We pray for an awakening in our nation, that the voice of Jesus would be heard and all people would lift him up and want to live for his glory. Let's pray together. Lord, today when we sing a song like this, how we need you, there is a multitude of prayers that are being prayed with that song. There are people who need healing, and people who need guidance, and people who need relationships restored. And so we bow our head today in singing these songs and say to you, they're not just platitudes, but we desperately need you in our life. So we pray you would forgive us when we try to chart our own path, that you would help us be an example of your grace to the world. We pray for President Trump and President Biden and all who make big decisions about how to deal with these complicated issues. And we ask for you to lead them when they didn't even know you were leading them, so that you would bring peace and hope and life to our communities. And we pray, Lord, that indeed you would awaken the church, call us to prayer, call us to holiness and righteousness, and use our love to draw people to your great grace. Lord, in this world, there are troubles, but you have promised us that you have overcome the world. And so we give ourselves to you today to speak to us through your word and your spirit, not only to encourage us, but to empower us to be examples of your love in our homes, our city, our nation and world. In the wonderful saving name of Jesus, we pray.
This last song together and praise him for who he is and his strength and his power in our lives. The Bible is very clear that God is worthy of our praise. So friends, let's sing this out. Let's give him the glory that he is due. Let's sing this together.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Could ever save. worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. You are worthy, God, worthy of every song. Worthy of all the praise we could ever give. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Sing, Holy God, holy. There is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show.
Are you listening? God whispers to us and you hear him. Perhaps it is a feeling in our gut, a sudden insight, or a message that comes to us through his word. Or maybe it is the stillness of nature, or the blowing of the wind and the sound of waves crashing on the shore. Whatever form it takes, God is whispering to us now, inviting us to listen and respond. It is in these moments of quiet and stillness that we truly hear God's voice. And when we do, we have a choice to make. We can ignore it, dismiss it as just another thought or feeling, or we can embrace it and allow it to transform us from the inside out. God's whispers has the power to change us, to move us, to heal us. It can give us the strength and courage to face our fears, to overcome our doubts, and to take bold steps towards a brighter future. When we follow God's gentle whispers, it has the power to shake the world, to bring about positive change and make a difference in the lives of those around us. So can you hear it? God is whispering to you. Are you listening?
There I am. When I go to other cultures in the world, I'm always amazed at how much I like stuff that I didn't grow up with. It might be their food, it might be their clothes, of course their language is different, and you have to adjust sometimes to cultural things in your communication and in your training or in your teaching. And I remember a couple times one of the things I discovered that were really different is humor, what's funny. And especially when you're using an interpreter. So when I'm trying to be funny in another culture, I asked my translator, I said, please make me funny. Make me funny. He said, Steve, I took one look at you and I already decided you're funny. And here's the thing, I know some people in here would say, get a translator to make you funny. But the whole point is humor is not always culturally able to be crossed over into other ideas or other upbringings. And what's interesting is how we deal with crisis is another thing, that people don't always do the same as you go to different places in the world. Now, to be honest with you, after yesterday's events, I was kind of wrestling with the idea that I needed a different sermon for today than the one I'd prepared. And then I began to think about it, that Jesus, in the passage that we're going to talk about today, was all about preparing his disciples for crisis. And it's a crisis that we're in as a nation and really that the world is in, but nations and worlds are made up of communities and families. And so how do we get help in this crisis? Well, Jesus tells us. You know, we've been on this theme all year about what he said, big things he wants you to know. Stuff Jesus said directly. And so this series that we've been talking about the last few weeks is what he said about you. And we talked about how God loves you and how you're designed to love him. That's your purpose. And that yet your heart is broken because of brokenness just in the world, and yet he's come to our rescue. Well, today I want to talk to you about the fact that you are also countercultural. And if you brought a Bible or you have a device with the Bible on it, I want you to go to John chapter 17. And here we find what's been faithfully called or over the years traditionally called Jesus' high priestly prayer. Now, he's getting his disciples ready for a crisis. They have no idea what they're about to face in that he's going to be tried, arrested and tried and ultimately beaten and crucified on a cross. And so in teaching them all of these things about him so they will have confidence in him, he begins to pray for them. And in that prayer, we find him crying out to God for a big thing in their life. Let's look at this. Verse 13 of John chapter 17. Here's what he says. Now I'm coming to you, he says to God. I told them many things while I was with them in this world so they would be filled with my joy. Joy. Now I want to stop there before we read the rest of the passage and just unpack that little part of his prayer, because Jesus said he wants you to have his joy. Now, at first glance, and you see a statement like that, you think, well, that seems pretty obvious, but what is he talking about? Well, I think the question is, what makes you happy? And you think about it. Well, what does make me happy? My family makes me happy. My hobbies make me happy. My stuff makes me happy. I mean, I just think about all these things that make me happy, and all of those things are great and fine, and you can try to find fulfillment in them. But when Jesus prays to the Lord for you here, he is intentional about the word that he chooses. This word that we translate in English, joy, comes from the Greek word that he used, chara, which means simply this, a deep-seated happiness. So in other words, not a happiness that's based on my circumstances. Am I getting everything I want? Is everything in my life perfect? Am I healthy? Is all of that great? And he's saying it goes much deeper than just happiness associated with your circumstances or your stuff. Whenever this word is used in Scripture, it's always used as a spiritual reality. In other words, a deep gladness of the heart. So when I ask you, do you have joy? It's not just, are you happy? But are you filled foundationally with this confidence of who Jesus is? And that happiness transcends the stuff that you can just accumulate or the fleeting happiness that comes from circumstances. It's a foundational joy attached to your complete confidence of who he is and his place in this world and in fact, your world. Now here's what Jesus understood about his disciples and then ultimately what he understood about you, because he tells us that he's not only praying for the disciples, he's praying for everyone who would become a believer in him in subsequent generations. And here's what he says. You are always searching for joy and happiness. But the thing is, you often try to find that joy and happiness in the wrong places. And while you might find a thrill or a desire met in some of those places, a longing for lasting joy, deep-seated gladness, remains in you. And this is the joy Jesus is praying for you, not just his disciples, for you. Jesus prays, let's see it again, I told them many things while I was with them in this world, so they would be filled with my joy. So he tells us everything we have recorded in Scripture is meant to give us great joy if we'll trust it. If we'll read this word and apply it to our lives, we'll actually experience this deep-seated gladness that Jesus was praying for. It's important to remember, Jesus didn't come to this world with a bunch of rules and regulations. We oftentimes get confused about that. His primary message was that God loves you. And this is what he wants you to get. And if you embrace that and trust that God's love is real and in your best interest, then his lifestyle direction doesn't feel like a burden of requirements. Rather, you believe that it is in your best interest and you follow his commands. Your joy is what motivated that whole design. Now, it might sound weird to say that to these disciples who are about to go through a monumental crisis that none of us could fully grasp. And it's interesting, if you look in the book of Acts, in Acts chapter 5, these guys now have seen Jesus risen from the dead. They watched him ascend into heaven, and they've been filled, had this amazing experience of being filled with the Holy Spirit. And so they're out now in Jerusalem healing people. I mean, truly healing people from everything imaginable. And the people who killed Jesus were not happy about this. Now think about that. These guys are healing people and they're upset. And so they come and threaten them. And they beat them and they tell them, do not keep speaking in Jesus' name. It was funny because they just looked at them and here was their crisis moment, and yet they spoke with respect and said, hey guys, you can tell us not to, but we can't stop speaking about what we've seen and what we've heard. And they threatened them some more and sent them back. Now here's the big part. Here's what they said. When they got together with all of their friends in the church who were followers of Jesus now, it said that they counted it all joy that they got to suffer for Jesus' name. Now think about that. Do you wake up in the morning and if you're suffering, you say, hey, I'm full of joy? You know, it's a challenge to think of your life that way, and yet that's how the disciples responded to the challenge before them. Now, look, I was taught God doesn't want you to be happy. He wants you to be holy. But then I've come to understand, actually, he wants you to be both. And the more that you get in tune with what his spirit wants for your life, the more full of joy, again, not surface happiness associated with your circumstances, but deep-seated gladness, the more deep-seated gladness you're going to experience, the closer you walk to him. God wants you to be holy, which leads to your joy. Now, how does that happen? Well, Jesus keeps praying. And get ready, because at first hearing, it doesn't sound like a lot of joy in this prayer, but stay with him, okay? John 17, beginning with verse 14. I have given them your word, and the world hates them because they do not belong to the world, just as I do not belong to the world. I'm not asking you to take them out of the world, but to keep them safe from the evil one. You see, it's simply this. Jesus says, people won't like you because you follow him. Now, I wanted to come up with some really catchy phrase for that, but that's the bottom line. For people who are followers of Jesus, his promise is that there will be a lot of people who don't like you. Now, raise your hand if you love being hated. You love being hated, yeah. You wake up in the morning and you're like, what I really enjoy is being hated by other people. But yet Jesus is saying that's going to be what happens. But most of us, we want to be liked. We want to be appreciated. We want to be included and brought in. I mean, right? But in most of us wanting to be liked, this desire impacts how we act and speak. And for some, even impacts what we believe to be true. I want to believe everything everybody around me believes is true so that I can be accepted by everybody around me. We can all be right, can't we? Well, that's sometimes how we think. And when Jesus was praying for his followers, he acknowledged to God that the world would, his word, hate them because they lived by a different standard. Some followers aren't ready to hear this. And sometimes they even make the opposite come true. Now, to be honest, it's a very fine line, and I get that. For example, also in the book of Acts, it tells us that because of the behavior and the attitude of the Christ followers toward each other, and the way they loved each other and cared for each other and shared with each other as they had need, that people in their community were attracted to them. And upon seeing why they behaved that way, they were following Jesus, they too became followers of Jesus. So their message and their ability to relate to their culture with compassion was attractive to people who weren't yet followers of Jesus. You see, Jesus knew his own reality, though, would be crucifixion. No one wants crucifixion. So Jesus prays for them that God will protect them because if they are crucifying him, all of these people, they aren't exactly interested in becoming besties with these guys now who are followers of his. They understand that Jesus made it clear in his prayer. If you're seeking him and following his design for your life, most people, or he refers to them as the world, will not receive you well. Now, why is this? Well, it's because the world has chosen to rebel against what God values and what God designed for the human experience and what God established to be good and true and best and right for the human race. Now, most people believe that they're better judges of how to achieve happiness than God is, and so that's why they rebel against him. And that rebellion puts them at odds with your obedience if you're a follower of Jesus. So your values, your morals, your priorities are different, and your beliefs that some things are best for the culture will raise opposition. And when you share that with the culture, you might even find out that they become your, here it is, enemies. Who wants an enemy? Nobody wants an enemy. But sometimes because we do the right thing, enemies rise up against us, sometimes angry, sometimes violent, sometimes judgmental and demeaning and undermining. Oftentimes we find people so opposed to the values of Jesus that they do everything they can to crush them. And that can put a strain on your spirit because you have a desire to be liked and appreciated and connected. You know, it's interesting that we try to do that, is speak the language of our culture, even here in Midwest America in the 21st century. We want to understand people, and we want to relate our lives and the gospel to their life. And we want to be loving and peaceful and respectful and patient. And we want to seek to know the language in order to speak the language. But sometimes we forget, and here it is, and Jesus said it, that our message is countercultural. That if we're actually going to believe and communicate and live by Jesus' message, it will go against the flow of culture. Let me give you an example. The Word, the Bible, Scripture, and Jesus affirmed that we are all supposed to sexually express ourselves in the context of a marriage between a man and a woman. Now, the minute you say that, the minute that is read, or the minute I even say it from this platform, I put myself at odds with over 50% of our culture. And we're not just talking about sexuality here, because we could be talking about heterosexuality, viewing that differently. But the fact that you just say it or believe that that's true goes against the norm of culture. And when we say this, we are immediately at odds with them. Now, as a church, we're challenged in how we communicate and teach the Word of God so people are attracted to or drawn to the gospel by His Spirit. But it's challenging because we want them to be attracted to this gospel without compromising it. And so I get that. It's hard. And Jesus knows the challenges of being countercultural. So He prays for God to protect His followers. And that protection wasn't only for their physical well-being as much as it was for their spiritual well-being. The pressure of culture to comply can cause a person to doubt Jesus, doubt God's word, and doubt faith that in both is best for your life. So he prays the Lord will provide spiritual protection to help them to stay true to him. Now, in their case, the pressure was a lot of things. They were threatened physically. They were ostracized by their communities. I mean, some families even kicked these new believers out of their families because they were no longer following their traditional religion. And so the Lord prays that this spiritual protection he's asking for will help them stay true to him. But he keeps praying. Why? Well, don't forget, their joy was his goal. So jump down now to verse 16, and let's read the rest of what we're going to unpack this morning. Jesus prays to God, "They do not belong to this world any more than I do. Make them holy by your truth. Teach them your word, which is truth. And just as you sent me into the world, I'm sending them into the world. And I give myself as a holy sacrifice for them so they can be made holy by your truth." Jesus says he's sending you into the world to make you completely different from the world. Now, it's important for us to get that because we can come and warm these chairs on a Sunday and listen to Steve pontificate about Scripture and feel like we've really done our Christian duty when it's so about so much more than what happens in this space on Sunday morning. Jesus is calling us to a life that's different than a lot of the lives we intersect with on a daily basis. What we like to do is speak the language of culture in order to communicate this truth of the gospel to it, but sometimes, in an effort to relate, we can care about people and compromise the truth. Right motives, wrong method. Now, I've had a lot of discussions with pastors and other ministry leaders as to the best methods to use to share the love of Jesus Christ with the people of the world, particularly the people you and I live with on a daily basis. And while Jesus made it clear before he left this earth that we are to make followers, he also made it clear that we don't accomplish that by compromising his word and what is true. I mean, look closely at the prayer. This is significant. Remember what he said. Make them holy by your truth and teach them your word, which is truth. Another translation uses the word sanctify them by truth. I did it. I brought a churchy word today. Sanctify them. Now, to understand that word then that Jesus is talking about in his prayer, you actually have to go back to the Old Testament, because the word sanctify was used when a priest was about to go into the Holy of Holies, the great high priest. He had to sanctify himself before he went into the presence of a holy God. And so God gave him a lot of ways that he could ritualistically do that to prepare not only himself physically, but to prepare his heart to go into the presence of holy God. And so it's a very important word that he uses here, sanctify, because its meaning shows us something unique happens in us when we are fully devoted to him. This word was from the word that actually talked about not just who you are as you walk into God to offer a sacrifice. It talked about who you are in your own spirit as you walk through your daily life. Am I that committed to God that I'm going to be completely different from the world and what I look at as good and best and true and right for my life? And so the Apostle Paul, in writing to his friends in a town called Thessalonica, said it this way to them. Listen carefully to what he said. Now may the God of peace himself sanctify you entirely, and may your spirit and soul and body be kept complete without blame at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Faithful is he who calls you, and he also will do it. And so Paul's helping us understand that when Jesus prayed for their holiness or their sanctification, by definition, he's saying they are different from the world, because the word itself means you are set apart for a holy purpose. Now, I have to be honest with you. Sometimes when we talk to people about becoming Christ followers and receiving his forgiveness and his salvation, they aren't thinking that far ahead in their life, well, this means my whole world's going to change. Sometimes they just, we refer to it as they just want fire insurance. They just want to know that they're going to go to heaven and not go to hell when they die. And they won't realize that to be a follower of Jesus means to die to yourself and allow his spirit to completely transform your spirit. So your passionate desire is to live a life under the design of the human experience that he has created for you. And so he not only saves you when you believe, but he offers you the power, the opportunity to be empowered by his Holy Spirit to live a holy life in an unholy world. Now, that's important for you to understand, because a lot of times people think that that's just not doing certain things. I have this list of things that I'm not supposed to do. When I was a youth pastor, we used to all boil it down to don't drink, smoke, cuss, chew, and date girls that do. That was what we taught. Just don't do those things. And yet, we're so much more than that, is what Jesus is telling us. He said, really, it's not about what you're not doing, but actually what I'm going to put within you that I want you chasing hard after every day. And because you're chasing so hard after those things every day, you don't have to worry about the stuff you're not supposed to do, because you'll be too busy and too focused on doing the things you're supposed to be doing. Now, how do you do that? How do you engage the culture when you are to be different in the midst of it? Well, look, I get it. It's good to be involved. And fortunately, we live in a nation where we're allowed to speak freely, and we can tell people whatever we want to tell them without threat of being put in prison for it. And so because of that, a lot of believers want to contribute to the dialogue that goes on as to what would be best for our society, the things that we should live by and the ways that God designed us. But listen to me, mocking and being disrespectful and name-calling, none of that helps your witness for Jesus. Calling people idiots and morons on your social media does not say to people you're filled with the love of Christ. And when you're going on there and ranting about all the sin in the world, which it is a sinful world, and that you have, and your ideas are to basically beat down those who believe something completely different than you believe, hey, you're not drawing people to Jesus with that disrespect. Now look, no one's saying that we don't tell the truth. Absolutely, that's what we do. But it's how we tell the truth that matters. Do we do it with respect and honor? Do we do it with applying value to the people who will read our posts or hear our talk about these issues? See, how does it help your neighbor come to Jesus if you're always insulting them? And that doesn't mean that you don't speak truth, but you speak it in love. I mean, what if we used respectful conversation? Yelling and mocking and name-calling men and women is not convincing. And a lot of times when we can't convince, we just increase the volume because somehow we believe that if we just yell, that somehow everybody will now believe us, which is what people are saying. You know, you kind of preach like that, Steve. You probably ought to calm down. I say, I just get excited. But are we respecting the people that we're talking to as we bring them the truth? Jesus prayed it. They are in the world, but they are not of the world. And being in the world not only means that we don't do a lot of the things that our culture does or we do them differently, but it also means that we speak more like Jesus than we speak like the world. I just got to be honest with you. There are a lot of Christian believers who are more discipled by their favorite cable news pundit than they are the Word of God. And it's time that we admit that. And it's time that we recognize. I'm not dissing anybody's favorite cable pundit. But I'm saying we have to interpret all that's said through the filter of God's word and God's spirit and Jesus' mission, because we want to bring his voice and his spirit to this world. So before speaking and posting, ask yourself, how is how I'm saying this going to impact those who read it or hear it? Not just will they disagree with it, but will they see that I've communicated it with love and honor and respect? I may be right in message, but wrong in tone and attitude. And Jesus is sending you into the world to be completely different from the world, including how you communicate to the world. And this means our behaviors being led by his word, but also our method of communicating his message is led by his spirit. And if loving God and loving my neighbor are the two most important commands he gives me, that should be evident to the world in how I engage them. So how will I find then this joy that Jesus is praying about? Well, he says, choose sanctification. And when you choose sanctification, you're choosing to give your entire spirit over to his control. And you know what he does? He fills you with his love. And then love becomes your mentality. That mentality that says, I'm going to think differently, that I'm living for eternity and not just for what I experience on this planet in this lifetime. And because of that, I'm going to love God above all things and seek his purpose in my life. And then as a result of that, I'm going to love my neighbor as myself, and I'm going to love my neighbor with respect and honor, even if they 100% disagree with who I've chosen to follow in my life. And then he promises that when I practice those three things, my mentality being eternal, my love for God being my passion and my love for people being my response, he promises we will have his joy. And when it's all said and done, that's what we're looking for more than anything. And that's what he said. And it's a huge thing that he wants you to know. And he wants you to experience. Let's pray together. Lord, thank you so much for the way you encourage us with your word, because we do go through a crisis, whether it's in our own health or our own family, whether it's in our career, whether it's in our nation or a community. Crisis happens, and we want to be men and women of character, men and women who trust completely that you are real and that you can be trusted and followed. So Lord, right now in this moment, help us to know what to pray in response to what we heard. Help us to commit in this moment to die to ourselves and receive your spirit into our heart and mind, and change the way we think and the way we speak, so that we are countercultural, not only in what we don't do, but what we do. So show us what to pray right now in response to this word and your spirit. You go ahead and pray and ask the Lord to help you receive his holiness, to walk for his glory. You pray. One thing we understand, Jesus, is that today is just perhaps a beginning for many. And yet you've convicted us and you've opened up our hearts to your grace and mercy. So thank you for your forgiveness and your great love. And now, as you've heard our prayers, we pray you'd seal them to our hearts and do a work in us so that the world can see you are alive in us. We give ourselves to you to that end, because you are enough for us. In your name we pray. Amen. Come on, let's worship him and sing to him today. Give him the glory that he deserves.
Christ is my reward, all of my devotion. Now there's nothing in this world can ever satisfy. Through every trial, the soul will sing, no turning. Set free. Christ is enough for me. Christ is enough for me. Everything I need is in him. Everything I need. Christ, my own. Joy of my salvation, and this hope will never fail. Heaven is our home. Through every storm, my soul will sing. Jesus is here. To God be the glory. Christ is
I've decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. The cross before me, the world behind me. No turning back, no turning back. The cross before me.
Follow him with no compromise. For all of you with us online, thanks so much for being part of the service today. Stick around for just a minute, and Ben's going to talk a little bit more about how you can respond to what you experienced today in worship at Southland. And hey, we want to hear from you, so use the chat or use email. Let us know what God's doing in your life. And of course, as always, we hope you get back here in this space with us soon. We'd love the opportunity to connect with you that way and worship with you. God bless you. Have a great week in the Lord.